different artists can interpret the same subject matter in unique ways. These deviations from the common shape are known as artistic license. There are few characters that have been subject to more artistic license than the clown prince of crime, the Joker.
That's what all the people say.
Using such elements as costumes and makeup, props, and physicality, directors and actors have reinvented the Joker to fit very specific worlds and aesthetics.
I've been a puppet, a pauper, a pirate, a poet, a pawn and a king. I've been up and down and over and out, and I know one thing.
In this video, we're going to look at how Tim Burton, Christopher Nolan, and Todd Phillips each exercise artistic license with the Joker.
I roll myself up in a big ball. And
before we dive into the madness, remember to subscribe below and click the bell icon to stay notified.
And here we go.
There are certain aspects of the Joker's appearance that have made him so iconic. The green hair, the purple suit, white face paint, and the bright red lips. Each film takes a vastly different approach to this iconic villain.
You can call me Joker.
When it comes to costume design, few directors are as bold and expressive as Tim Burton. He's a master of visual design, known for his gothic aesthetic. In this case, Burton's Gotham is an Art Deco film noir metropolis. The city is devoid of color. It is cold and gray, which makes the colorful and vibrant appearance of the Joker shocking.
And where is the Batman?
The Joker's color palette pops against the dark tones of Gotham City. And especially its hero. On the other hand, Christopher Nolan desaturates the Joker's color palette to blend into a more grounded vision of Gotham City.
And I thought my jokes were bad.
The green hair is faded, the purple suit barely registers, the white face paint cracked and wearing off, the red lipstick haphazardly applied over a sinister, permanent grin.
You see, this is how crazy Batman's made Gotham.
Unlike Burton's Joker, who visually disrupts the status quo, Nolan's Joker is a product of it.
Introduce a little anarchy.
The world made him.
Upset the established order, and everything becomes chaos.
And so he blends in. Todd Phillips gives us a combination of the previous two.
Smile, though your heart is aching, smile.
Nolan's gritty realism with a return to Burton's more vibrant color palette. Arthur Fleck is a troubled loner, broken down by the world around him. His connection to the Joker costume and makeup is more practical and motivated. Phillips keeps the green hair, white face, and red lips, with the purple replaced with a dark red, a subtle but noticeable deviation from the character's roots. Besides the immediate visual presentation of the Joker, he is also known through iconic props. This relationship to props can be traced all the way back through Joker's mythology. These props are often modified novelty gags, beginning with his signature and deadly playing cards.
By golly!
Looky here!
So, how do Tim Burton, Christopher Nolan, and Todd Phillips approach props in their different characters? Burton's Joker is the most playful, so his props must reflect that.
Life's been good to me.
When one of Gotham's crime lords speaks out against him,
what if we say no?
It's a classic practical joke device made lethal by the Joker. We also get Joker's acid-squirting lapel flower, a laughably large gun, and a deadly quill. This relationship with prop weapons is much more in line with Joker's original comic book persona. But subsequent versions of the Clown Prince tend to downplay this aspect.
Let's not blow this out of proportion.
The Joker in Nolan's film mostly forgoes the novelty gag props for much more direct weaponry. Guns, knives, and rocket launchers become part of Joker's arsenal. But that doesn't mean he's lost his sense of humor.
How about a magic trick? I'm gonna make this pencil disappear. Ta-da! It's gone.
The mix of humor and violence is pure Joker.
Hi.
Despite having been a working clown, Phillips' Joker has no connection to this combination of playful violence. In fact, he doesn't begin as a violent character at all.
She says I was put here to spread joy and laughter.
It is only by necessity that violence becomes an option. Similar to Nolan's character, Arthur also uses knives and guns in ways more savage and raw than ever. Which leads us to our last topic, physicality. We've established Burton's ironic use of clown tropes for treachery. So when it's time to get physical, his Joker loves to dance. Combined with his flamboyant outfits, this Joker is as big and outrageous as possible. In The Dark Knight, the Joker's physicality is restrained. He hunches his shoulders, hugs his arms to his sides, and drifts like a shadow. He only moves when he has to. He is always three steps ahead of his enemies, so there's no need to rush. In Joker, the physicality is brought front and center. Arthur's body is constantly on display. Perhaps as a way for us to make the connection between a malnourished body and a malnourished mind. Like Burton's character, this Joker is also prone to dancing, but without joy. It's more raw and intimate. It is only in the end that Arthur's dancing becomes an act of triumph. Now that we've seen so many interpretations of the Joker, where can the character go from here? Give us your thoughts in the comments.
Oh, you made it. I'm so thrilled.
Who is your favorite Joker? We've ranked our favorites, including all the versions from TV, animation, and video games. And you'll find it on the Studio Binder blog.
Good night. And always remember, that's...
If you don't subscribe, you're going to miss out on videos like these. Click the bell for reminders.